It's time for another episode of Cinematic Excrement, and today I have a special treat for you. We're going to look at a film called Hercules in New York. This film is somewhat infamous for two reasons. One, for being the smoldering heap of rat feces, and two, for being the big screen debut of Mr. Arnold Schwarzenegger. Oh, excuse me, I meant to say Arnold Strong. I guess they thought people wouldn't be able to pronounce Schwarzenegger, so they changed it to something simpler. I guess I can understand where they're coming from, and it's not at all uncommon for an actor to use a stage name, but... really? Arnold Strong? That's the best you could come up with?
Arnold Strong! You weak!
The film was released in 1970, and is also known by the alternate titles of simply Hercules and Hercules Goes Bananas. Arnold plays the titular character, and as I said, this was his film debut. Now, don't get me wrong, I love Arnold Schwarzenegger, but I think we can agree that he's never exactly delivered an Oscar-worthy performance. So you can imagine just how horrifying his film debut must have been. Well, you need not imagine it anymore. Now you get to see it firsthand! May God have mercy on your souls. So we start off on Mount Olympus with Hercules having an argument with his father Zeus. Wait, hold it. Hercules is the Roman name for the character, known in Greek mythology as Heracles, but Zeus is the Greek name for the god, known in Roman mythology as Jupiter. We're not 1 minute in and they've already screwed up. That's a bad sign. Anyway, Hercules is whining because he wants to travel down to Earth, and he really comes across as a spoiled brat here. But Dad, Mars gets to go to Earth all the time, why can't I? Mars, another Roman name. Zeus forbids him to leave Mount Olympus, but Hercules insists on it because he's bored!
It may not be entirely without merit, but you wouldn't like it down there.
Let me be the judge of that. I'm tired of the same old faces, the same old things.
Tired or not, you're staying here!
Oh, yes, I forgot to mention. Arnold hadn't really perfected his English by this point, and people couldn't understand a word he was saying. Plus, he had little acting ability and couldn't emote worth crap. So they dubbed all of his dialogue. Nowadays, if you can find this movie on DVD, it will have the option to hear the original audio track with Arnold's voice left intact.
I am tired of the same old faces, the same old things.
And the more you listen to it, the more it becomes abundantly clear why it was dubbed. Anyway, the argument between Zeus and Hercules becomes quite heated. Venus tries to intervene on Hercules' behalf, but he tells her to butt out. Venus. So that's three Roman and one Greek. Let's keep count, shall we? Ultimately, Zeus decides he's had enough and throws a thunderbolt prop at him that looks really low budget even for 1970. When the smoke clears, Hercules has vanished.
Zeus! Hercules is half mortal. He may be killed. He's only a spoiled youth, Zeus. Save him. Hercules is...
Whoa! Holy diver, what was that? I guess now I know where Sensational Sherry got her makeup ideas. When the smoke clears, Hercules has left Mount Olympus and is now swimming in the ocean somewhere on Earth. Zeus' wife, Juno, thinks he should be left alone to suffer the consequences of his own actions, but the other goddesses plead with Zeus to help him.
It will take more than Neptune or any of his creatures to overcome a son of Zeus.
Save him, Zeus!
Save Hercules!
All right. I have done so. Behold, coming over the horizon of the sea.
Over the horizon comes... the lighting crew. So Hercules is rescued by a cargo ship.
What were you doing out there in the water?
Swimming.
Duh.
What's your name?
Hercules.
Greek, huh?
No, Roman. We went over this already. Well, technically he's Austrian, but he's playing a Roman, but calling himself Greek.
I'm a dude playing a dude disguised as another dude.
Yeah, something like that. So they provide him with some clothes as he came down to Earth naked for some reason, and they try to put him to work. But once again, Hercules starts acting like a spoiled brat and refuses to take orders from anyone.
You cannot tell me what to do. Nobody gives orders to the mighty Hercules.
Finally, they dock in New York City.
New York City!
And he leaves the ship.
What is this doing here? It does not go here.
There, that's better. They try to stop him from leaving the ship, which makes absolutely no sense. Given all the trouble he's caused, they should be glad to get rid of him. So another fight ensues. Oh, come on. That didn't even come close to hitting him. Oh, neither did that. What the hell? Ah, shit, not far enough. Ah! While this is going on, a pretzel vendor, who goes by the name Pretzi, isn't that creative, watches the fight closely. Pretzi is played by the late Arnold Stang. Once Hercules fights off the angry sailors, Pretzi, for no apparent reason, decides to help him out and tells him to run for it. On the way out, Hercules stops this forklift driver? Why is he doing this? Could something in this movie make sense, please?
Fine chariot, but where are the horses?
A fine sherry... what? Hang on, let's switch to the dub.
A fine chariot, but where are the horses?
Oh, a fine chariot. Okay. That's not funny, but at least I understood it. So Pretzi and Herc get a cab, and they start talking about an old acquaintance of Pretzi's called Apollo. Of course, this leads to confusion, as Pretzi is talking about an actual person, and Hercules thinks he's referring to the god. There's not much to say about this scene, except my god, is it boring. It's not funny, it adds nothing to the story, it's completely pointless.
I wonder if Apollo ever got married. You know, he was all the time looking for a wife, always looking for a wife. Well, maybe that's why he went back home, to find a wife, huh?
Diane and the Psychiri are in love with him. I think Hebe is attracted too.
I'm not sure how I understood that, but that's one Roman and two Greek. Apollo's name is the same in both, so I'm not counting him. They finally stop in Central Park, and the cabbie has the audacity to demand that they pay him for the ride. Of course, Herc has no cash, and Pretzi seems to be broke also. Guess those pretzels weren't selling well.
You don't have any money? Holy moly, he ain't got no money.
Hercules doesn't need any money.
What? That's about the stupidest thing I ever heard in my whole life.
Oh, don't say that yet, Pretzi. We're not even 20 minutes into the movie. So the cabbie tries to take the fare out of their asses, but Herc makes quick work of him and then flips the cab on its side. Then he and Pretzi make a run for it. Hercules, the thief and the vandal. Our hero, ladies and gentlemen. So after running through the park, they come across a university track and field team practicing. Hercules takes one look at them and remarks that they don't look very skilled. Pretzi balks at the idea, but then Hercules walks up to the coach and tells him that he wants to show these mere humans how to throw the discus properly. The coach decides to humor the guy, but much to his surprise, Herc launches the discus clear across the field. Then the coach asks him if he can demonstrate a javelin throw as well. Man, even Arnold's pecs have to mug for the camera. Of course, he sets a new world record in the javelin as well. Then he is asked to demonstrate a long jump. Okay, given what we've seen so far, I think I know what will happen. They'll show him leaving the ground, and then immediately cut to everyone doing this. And then show him landing. Sometimes I hate being right. The actions of Hercules catch the eye of several onlookers, including Professor Camden and his daughter Helen. The professor is played by James Caron, who you probably recognize but can't figure out why. That's because he's made brief appearances for pretty much every TV show ever. Anyway, he invites Pretzi and Hercules over for tea, and both men continue to make asses out of themselves. First, Pretzi scratches his back with some antlers sitting on the mantelpiece.
Ben. Bud. The funny one.
Why is Arnold laughing like Beavis and Butthead? Then Hercules proceeds to stare at Helen in an extremely creepy fashion, now we know where Edward Cullen learned it, and then he makes a rather blunt remark about Helen's boyfriend Rod.
Hey, what's happening?
Is he your lover?
My what?
Hey, mister, watch your talk.
I can hear my dog. I cannot watch it.
It's your language. I'm just trying to use it, that's all.
Of course, this leads to a fight, if you can call picking someone up and carrying them around a fight. The next day, we find Helen and her father discussing the incident, and she mentions that after all of that, Hercules actually had the gall to ask her to have dinner with him.
Well, of course you told him.
I would.
Naturally.
Eh, makes about as much sense as anything else we've seen so far. We'll go with it. So that afternoon, that evening, Herc and Helen go for a carriage ride through the park. Around the same time that evening, that afternoon... Okay, would the movie make up its mind what time of day it's supposed to be? Anyway, during that... time of day, a grizzly bear escapes from the zoo. Oh, dear sweet lord, what is that?
That's just a guy in a suit!
Of course, the bear eventually meets up with Herc and Helen, and Herc tries to fight off the bear. At least, I think that's what's supposed to be going on here. It doesn't look like much of a fight to me. At this point, Helen does about the most unconvincing feint I've ever seen in a motion picture. Eventually, Herc subdues the bear, and this gives Pretzi a great money-making idea. Hercules should become a professional wrestler. Oddly enough, there was a wrestler called Hercules who wrestled for the WWF in the 1980s.
This has been another useless fact.
Anyway, you'd think this would lead to footage of Hercules wrestling. And it does. For about 8 seconds. That's it. I just showed you all the wrestling footage. I know this movie didn't have much of a budget, but no budget is no excuse for no effort. The only reason the wrestling was even part of the plot in the first place is so we can introduce these mafia villains who want to buy Hercules' contract from Pretzi.
Hercules is my friend. I ain't gonna sell him to nobody. Not to you, or him, or him.
Now look, that boy of yours is a comer.
Wait, what?
Now look, that boy of yours is a comer.
Nope, not touching that one. After much pressure, a large cash offering, and some not-so-subtle threats, Pretzi signs Hercules over to them. Meanwhile, back on Olympus...
I would speak with Nemesis!
So Zeus orders Nemesis to go to New York and take vengeance on Hercules for defying him and soiling the good name of the gods. But Mercury begs him to reconsider. Mercury requests that he be sent to try to convince Hercules to return to Olympus. After some encouragement from the others, apart from Juno, who, for obvious reasons, is not Hercules' biggest fan, Zeus agrees to give Herc one last chance. Meanwhile, back in New York, we get some more zany fun with Herc and Helen. And once again, Arnold's muscles have to mug for the camera. Oh, and check this scene out. That's right, Arnold actually trips over a crack in the sidewalk. There's no way Arnold could have made it look this convincing on purpose, so it had to be an accident. And they left it in the movie. God bless low-budget filmmakers. So Mercury pays a visit to Hercules and begs him to come back. Unsurprisingly, Herc refuses.
Do not defy Zeus. You can only suffer by it.
He's all the time nagging me.
Wait, your father is doing what to you? Well, hang on. Let's check the dub.
He is all the time nagging at me.
Oh, nagging! Okay. For a second, I thought you said you and your father were, you know what? Never mind. With his mission a failure, Mercury leaves and a half-drunk Pretzi witnesses him fly out the window.
I'm sure he meant well.
He
Well, at least someone in this movie knows how to faint properly.